welcome you to this course on presbyopia. Presbyopia remains one of the most sought after surgeries from the patient and one of the most difficult to satisfy the patient in any form. So we'll start off with the first presentation and
Friends, before Shashi starts, like we know Shashi as a pioneer of refractive surgery in this country. He started LASIK first in this country. But one of the most important thing is very, he's a think tank. He has got a lot of angles to look at a subject, and he will justify. So what is very important in evaluation of the presbyopic patient before you take him for surgery, because satisfaction of the patient is very important on evaluation and then choosing the different kind of surgeries to him. Shashi, please.
Thank you, Mr. Kankaria. So accommodation, can I have some more? Accommodation typically at an age of 12, we have about 14 diopters of accommodation with a very near point, very close at 7 centimeters. And this rapidly reduces. By 35, you hardly got 7 diopters left with a near point at 14. At 45, you are almost left with just 4 diopters of total accommodation. The total accommodation is not what we can use. There's reserve accommodation and things like that. And less than 4 is actually called presbyopia. So for years, 100 years, there have been various studies which confirm the same thing. If you see by 40, you hardly have about 4 diopters of accommodation left. After 40, it drops more rapidly than the gradual decline which occurs from the age of 10 to 20 to 30, 40. So we have regression formulas, clinical studies, and all of them come to the same thing. So how do we measure the amount of accommodation? You have to measure it. You have ready-made formulas like this, 18.5 minus 1/3 of age, and the results of these usually match the same studies and the regression formulas that have been taken. To actually measure clinically in a particular patient, you can bring the near point closer and closer till it blurs, and then calculate the reciprocal of that near point in meters, and that gives you the accommodation at that point. You can do it the other way also, that you bring it first the car very close to the patient and then go far away, and this gives you the accommodation that is there. Now, ocular dominance. Most of us in cataract surgery for the last 10 years have been involved in hearing about multifocal IOLs, or you know, put which lens in the dominant eye and correct the other eye for near and all that. So what is ocular dominance? The superiority of one eye over the other in some perceptual or motor task, so long as both eyes are equal otherwise, no pathology wise. Dominance is extremely complex. You can have sensory dominance, directional dominance, oculomotor dominance. The ways of testing them, you need those machines where you can see binocular rivalry, physiological diplopia, etc. The common clinical tests that we do actually tests only directional dominance. Now, a single individual will have all three types of dominance, but each eye might be different. The right eye might be sensory dominant, the left eye might be directional dominant. So which eye are we saying that when we do left for near, are we doing it for the sensory dominance? Are we doing it for directional dominance? Most of the time, it is very difficult to decide. And there's no, we are not testing them also, so there's no question of deciding. We don't even know what we are doing. So again, the degree of dominance. Some people are definitely dominant in the right eye for distance. Some become very equally alternating, and things like that. So you can have freely alternating, you can have equally strong left eye after some time. So there is no relevance of knowing which eye is dominant, because it could differ even in this manner. What we test most often is directional dominance. You make the patient make a hole with both hands, look at an object, occlude each eye. The eye with which he can still see is the dominant eye. If it's a distant object, for distance. Sensory dominance, like I said, binocular rivalry and all, there are different machines to test that, and resistance to blur is one of the ways to test sensory dominance. If you blur the eye with a plus 1.5, the eye which is difficult to blur is dominant. The eye which easily gets blurred is not dominant. Okay. So that is, you have found out the sensory dominance. The same thing can be done for near vision. And so finally, if you decide that a patient is right eye dominant, both distant and near, then what will you do? This patient will have difficulty adapting to monovision. Okay. So, for example, these people had a study where they did 9 different type of tests to test the different types of dominance in 51 emmetropic subjects. And there was no clear ocular dominance in any patient. Okay. There was no correlation or equivalence between the tests. So not only each test is testing something which is totally not equivalent somewhere else, there's no clear dominance. So should we still test? Yes. You should test so that if somebody is definitely dominant in one eye, he is a poor candidate for monovision. If you can't make out right, left, right, he's a good candidate. He's able to adapt to anything. But if he's very firmly dominant, and then you are probably he's not the best candidate. The various ways of correcting presbyopia, so everyone will be covering it. In that, angle kappa comes, say for example, multifocal IOLs. Should you use it in the multi, and various other situations. Now, angle kappa, you know, the traditional, you say you take a torch and you see that reflex which is nasal. Can we diagnose like this the center of the pupil? And the angle kappa is 0.5 millimeter. What is 0.5 millimeter? Who can look at a torch and say 0.5 millimeter, this is normal angle kappa? Or it is 0.6, it is a large angle kappa. So that was one of the most, so the way of measuring angle kappa was actually synoptophore. Who has got a synoptophore? Nobody in the whole country has a synoptophore. Use it, correct? So now it is still more complicated. On a synoptophore, the normal values is 2.7 and 3.3, different for right and left eye also. Second is, if you don't have a synoptophore and you're into LASIK and all, or the LASIK center has got an op scan. On an op scan, the normal value is 5.5 in a right eye, 5.6 in a left eye. If you updated your op scan, the values again change to 4.9 if you've got a 2Z version. So who really knows what is the normal angle kappa? Nobody knows. These are random patients whose op scans have been done at a LASIK center where I do the cases. This one's kappa is 1.9. You see the second last line there? Here. And now you see this patient is 4.06. These are normal myopes who underwent or came, were screened for LASIK. So this is normally, textbooks what's taught was that normal is 10 prism diopters, which is equal to 5 degrees, which is equal to 0.5 millimeter. Okay. So obviously this Hirschberg's thing, what you take a torch, is a very crude method and it's very difficult to know. It uses the principle of Purkinje images, and the first Purkinje image is used. So in multifocal IOLs, one recommendation is if angle kappa is more than half the central diameter before the ring start, there's a clear zone. If the angle kappa is more than that, so if you're commonly using Restore, if angle kappa is more than 0.4, which is half of the central ring of Restore, is not a good idea because the rays will start hitting the rings, the light going in. If you use Technis, you get 0.5 instead of 0.4. Now, the 0.1, we ourselves don't know what is normal kappa. Someone says on this machine is 5, on another machine is 3, on Synopta 4 is 2, and you're talking about 0.5 millimeter. So, technis is a better idea. We get little space, 0.5 millimeter space. All nonsense, I think. Anyway, so one proposed then, on top of this 0.5 millimeter game, so the, you know, the surgeons must have some way to continue the story. So they'll say that we decenter the lens during surgery. Now, which decenter? 0.5 millimeter? My friend here is one of the best surgeons I ever know, Irfan. We are classmates. And I don't know, Irfan, can you decenter 0.5 millimeter? No. So they say we decentered it 0.5 millimeter, and now we are on the visual axis and all that. Yeah. Correct. So then there is all the stories of memory of the haptics, contraction of the capsule, etc., etc., etc. But I think this just keeps everybody busy and everybody entertained, all this type of talk. Next is angle kappa in LASIK. So LASIK is traditionally centered on the pupil. Okay, so so many reasons given that photoreceptors are, you know, oriented towards the pupil center. And then is this coaxially sighted corneal reflex. So you close one eye, you look through that eye through the same binocular, and the patient is the same binocular, and his chin should be up, and he must look straight up, and what you see will be the thing. Now, the illumination should be coaxial. So the microscopes kept getting costlier, you know, from 10 lakhs to 20 lakhs to 30 lakhs to 50 lakhs to 100 lakhs. And if you ask them, no, this one is coaxial, coaxial. So finally, after getting it coaxial, you have to shift that 0.5 millimeter your lens, and you will know that where is the visual axis. Now, should you really try to go to the visual axis? Is the distance between the center of the pupil and visual axis really very great? And since nobody knows, so there's five people who said we went halfway and published a paper. Some people should have published that we went 1/3 way, and another few should have published that we went 2/3 way. The whole thing is 0.5. So somebody went 0.2 and said I went halfway, 0.25. Someone should have said I went 0.1 between the pupil center and the visual axis and all. This whole thing goes on. Ultimately, only the hyperopes have really large angle kappa, okay? So, this guy, Solar, 2011, he did a study in hyperopes. Now, he's an honest fellow. He compared pupil-centered versus decentering it on the corneal first Purkinje image, and he found no difference, okay, in anything, your usual efficacy, safety, but he's very honest. He says, my study is limited by a small sample size, and I only did mild to moderate hyperopes. Now, anyway, nobody is trying to correct +8 with a LASIK. So if +8 has a big angle kappa, and you say he didn't study that patient, anyway, most people don't want to correct +7, +8 with a LASIK. You want to correct mild to moderate hyperopes with a LASIK. Important point in presbyopia is depth of focus, which is crucial. When the pupil is small, this blur circle, which is forming on the retina, is small, irrespective of the refractive error, irrespective. So that itself gives you some visual benefit, okay? You see the first line is all hyperopes. With a large pupil in the last side, there's a big area of blur falling on the retina. The same refractive error, only the last line is the myopes. You see in the 6 millimeter pupil on the right end and in the emetrope. So this causes, look, upper line hypermetrope, just enlarging the pupil to 6 millimeter. Look at the blur. The myope, look at the blur. The pupil is a refractive element. Have we realized that this is the amount of blur caused by just changing the pupil size? So, the same thing can be used in reverse, that a small pupil could give you this much benefit visual. You don't need to put a camera inlay, buy a femto laser, make a femto pocket, pilocarpine eye drops, and you will have your Dr. Raman, chief of glaucoma in RP center. She says, I've got so many patients still on pilocarpine after the age of 40. They're so happy with their near vision. So the depth of focus can be used to get this benefit. This is how you would do it in a very complicated way and a very with a lot of costly equipment, sophisticated. You put a camera, it's usually just using a depth of focus. There are a lot of different ablation profiles with other people will discuss on how to get presbyopic correction. So depth of focus depends on the target properties also. The object, its luminance, contrast, etc., and also pupil diameter, and of course diffraction and aberrations. Diffraction is something which occurs whenever light passes through a circular opening and you get this airy disc pattern. You can't do anything about it. We have heard a lot about higher order aberrations. Higher order aberrations again play a positive role in depth of focus or depth of field. So if you have a spherical aberration, if you put a normal IOL, you are giving that patient depth of focus. If you put a costlier aspheric IOL, you have removed his depth of focus. And then you are worried how to make him presbyopic treatment. Okay. So you can see without spherical aberration, the top line, how the depth of focus disappears. Till minus 2, they can't see. See the lower line. Just having a little spherical aberration. So spherical aberration should be used to help presbyopic correction. Like this, you can see you add spherical aberration to a minus 1.5, you get that much improvement. Reduce pupil size a bit, you get this much improvement. Finally, with spherical aberration and small pupil, this is the amazing improvement in the visual quality. Thank you so much for everything.
Thank you, Shashi. It's very important. A science is still evolving, and a lot of things are coming up, and many of the things are permission and combination. You have to play around, and presbyopia surgery is still evolving and very interesting. And I will request Dr. Madhivan to kindly cover up the laser corneal surgery. Dr. M. Nishant, please.
A very good morning to one and all present here. I thank Dr. Kakaria sir for giving this opportunity. So I am going to give a brief introduction on how presbyopic LASIK plays a role for the treatment. So I've been doing this for the past 6 months to a year's time. I have the Schwinn Damaris machine, so what we call it as PresbyMax. So I'll try to explain how the presbyopic treatment as such works, what are the types of treatment, and let's have a good discussion in the end. So we all know the static techniques, that is the spectacles which are there for correcting, and then you have the contact lens, and you also do have the surgical ways to correct them. And then the dynamic presbyopic correction. So accommodative is always surgical, so there's roughly a split into lenticular and scleral treatment which was done earlier. Coming to the corneal approach. So we have the monovision LASIK and creating corneal multifocality, and then you have the combined approach. So what we are going to do is to see in depth about how we can create a corneal multifocality. So then you have the central presbylasic, the peripheral, and the laser brain vision, which is done by the presbyond. So what is monovision? So we all know that the near eye, which is near for clear, and the distance becomes blur, and the other eye where the near is blurred and the distance is clear. So as sir said previously, that the dominant eye is corrected for distance to almost plano, and whereas the non-dominant eye is corrected to be slightly more myopic for near vision, which can be done up to minus 2 diopters. So what is the pupil, how important is the pupil in terms of laser visor correction? So in terms of advantages, you have a clear focus with a sharp retinal image. It can be easily done and is independent of the pupil size. The disadvantage is it's anisometropia. More than one diopter will cause disadvantage in monovision, and the stereopsis will be lost. So coming to the central and the peripheral mode. So what we use in the Schwind MRS is the central mode, where the center is for the near vision and the intermediate is for the distant vision. So it creates a biaspheric ablation profile. And the advantage is it covers a whole range due to different foci for distance, intermediate and near. And is typically bilateral, which still keeps the stereopsis. But yes, there is a bit contrast sensitivity loss, and it takes time for neural adaptation. And this is also pupil size dependent, which I'll talk to you later in detail. So this is the suprachore, how the cornea changes its multifocality. And the presbyon, which is the laser blend vision. And this is the Schwind MRS. So it creates actually an extended depth of focus, where you have, I told you, the central vision, which is for the near, and then slowly as it goes to the periphery, it starts becoming for the distance vision. So this uses a blended central hyperpositive zone with a blended transition to distance in the pericentral cornea. You also have the monovision therapy, where one eye is corrected for distance and the other eye is also corrected for near. So what is the basic principle of presbyopic treatment? So it is actually similar to the principle of multifocal contact lenses or refractive multifocal intraocular lens, which are pupil size dependent. So the term biaspheric refers to the aspherical optimization of the central cornea area for near and the mid-periphery cornea for far for both eyes. So this is how actually the dominant eye and the non-dominant eye works in terms of presbyopic treatment. So before, in the earlier days, it was a symmetric correction. That is, near you make the patient a little more myopic, that is -1.9 for near vision, and then mid-periphery you make it -0.4. So the depth of focus is around 1.5, so patient will have little difficult in stereopsis. And then from symmetric we came to micro monovision, where the depth of focus was still 1.5 and the anisometropia for distance came up to 0.8. So then from micro monovision, which was done earlier, we have come to hybrid micro monovision. So what happens in this is you can see that the depth of focus from 1.5 has come down drastically to 0.8. So the acceptance of stereopsis for distance, the patients are more comfortable as we slightly do make the non-dominant eye from around 6.6 vision to 6.6 partial or 6.9. But because of the depth of focus and the pupil size, the patient are still able to read 6.6 for distance. So this is the slide which sums up all the three which I actually just spoke. For example, we are having an addition selection of +1.75. So what happens to the near eye, which is non-dominant? In all three, that is the micro monovision, the hybrid and the monocular, the non-dominant eye is always corrected for -1.8. This is in terms of how the system works. It is calculated in the system. You don't have to actually calculate this. But how much the patient is accepting with glasses is what you are going to enter. So finally, in the end, you are making the central -1.8, and in the mid-periphery, you are making it 0.9. But when you come to monovision, we know that it's only for distance, so we have made this distance as emmetrope. But in this hybrid, we can see that it corrects both the distance, and even the near, it comes down to -0.4. So in monocular, you completely correct only for distance, and this one is only for near. But in monovision and hybrid, we actually have this biasphericity where the patient is corrected for distance and near. So this depends upon the patient selection, which is very important, as we should know what is their main role, whether it is near, which is more, or they use it for driving distance and other activities. So this is the depth in which we get for the micro monovision hybrid and the monocular. We can see that there is a large area of overlapping, which happens in the micro mono vision. And hybrid are more clear to see for distance. The people who are myopic are actually more comfortable with this hybrid treatment, because I'm definitely sure myope do not want to leave that distance clarity for them. So what are the prerequisites to consider? Just like another refractive surgery, we always have to do all the workups such as dry eye evaluation, the lens evaluation, which is very important. I don't do this for patients who are just entering presbyopia. So for the people who are at the age of 40 to 45, I avoid them. It is like the range between 45 to 55 who are more comfortable, because they know that they have used their glasses once and they know that it is cumbersome and now they want to get rid of it. When a patient is using the glasses for the first time, you don't want to say that, no, I'm going to make you completely 6-6 and 6, and the patients will be really unsatisfied. So as they are older, you should also check for dryness, either the BOT and the shearmus. So we all know that the dryness is one of the main factors in terms of OLAXIC. It is not done to be as a surface treatment. One thing we should know is always presbyopic treatment, either it should be done only with a LASIK flap or a femto flap. So this is how the Schwind-Ameris machine imports for the refractive surgery. So we have the static cyclotorsion, which is check. So when the patient actually goes to sleep, the area of what the we take all the scans in sitting position. So same thing is incorporated for the patient in lying down position as well. So here, this is the page where we can see how the presbyopic treatment is done. So we can see that we have the distance eye which we have taken. The presbyopic add of around +2 is what we enter, and whether we want hybrid monocular or micro mono vision. Regarding the presbyopic reversal, I'll come to it later, which is an amazing feature as well. So micro mono vision, it creates a depth of focus in both the eyes. However, the dominant eye focuses slightly towards more far vision and the non-dominant eye towards near. The hybrid, which has a different depth of focus, is created for the dominant and the non-dominant eye. And monocular, we know that there is no depth of focus and the stereopsis is lost. So for this patient, when we select the hybrid, this, we know that this is the right eye. So I'll go in for the left eye first. So left eye is the dominant eye. So we can see that the patient is having a +0.5 with a -0.5, and we target them to come to 0. So this is what happens in the dominant eye. And then when you're coming over to the non-dominant eye, you can see that the patient is left with -0.89. If you remember the first slide which I put, that is what we are expecting for distance. The cylinder is completely corrected. So this is the amount of laser which is going to be done for the patient for correcting a near for the presbyopic add. This internal calculation is done by the machine itself. So then you have the page where you can go based it on the spherical aberration. But this Schwind machine does not go only on spherical aberration. I think it's the supracore. So as you can see that this is the normal pachy with the flap thickness of 110 being a femto, and you have the optical zone. So this is what you will be getting it post-operatively. So this is the right eye. And then this is the left eye which will have the correction. So what is the benefit in terms of flexibility? So when you go for mono vision, you can see that the patient either reads only for distance. And then mono vision adjusted Q value based laser vision correction, you can see that the near vision is more. And then you have the laser blend vision by the supracore. So there you can see that the distance is little undercorrected so that the patient is able to read more near. And then finally you have the supracore where the near is. So in the benefits of the Schwind, you can see that the three types which I told you, which is the micro mono vision, the hybrid and the presbymax. So this is the monocular where you correct only for near. And you see the depth in which the patient is able to read. So as Dr. Shashi sir said, that you are able to have a better depth of focus is what this machine gives in terms of correction for presbyopic LASIK. I would like to summarize by saying that yes, it works based on proper patient selection, and the patients are really happy. What I always say to them is try not to use one eye and compare. So if they have any doubts, I actually take them to the refraction cubicle and undercorrect them and say this is what you will get, and they understand more better. And the patient ametropic for distance for the most, and The most happy patients are the hyperopes, because whatever laser correction you do for them, they're really happy, and astigmatism patients as well. But myopes also, they are happy if their power is little on the higher side, where you say that, ask the patient whether it is only the distance which they want, or they want to use the gadgets more. So near vision is pure magic, it works amazing, and it also does work for pseudophakic patients. That's the beauty of it. Instead of the lens exchange and then you have to explant the lens and all that, whatever residual astigmatism or the power of either minus or plus they have, you can actually correct both their eyes after pseudo PCIOL and do give them near vision for both eyes. And the best thing I told you about reversal, yes, you have an option where you put a reversal after 6 months where the patient is still unhappy. It actually completely clears that biaspherity, and it does make the cornea plano. You just have to put the refraction what the patient is having at that time, and it is completely reversal after 6 months. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And can, is there any possibility for touch apps and enhancing
it? Yes, it is only for 3 to 5 years, ma'am. The studies which are there is also there. I think there's one by Nara Netralaya. So they say it is follow-up is only till around 3 to 5 years, because that's why I choose my patients. I'm very happy if they are nearing 50, because you can make it either 2.5 or 2.75. But definitely that is one of the main reason we don't do it from the age of 40 to 45. And you will need to do it again. It is not a permanent solution.
Why go for this and why not go for a lens-based multifocal, trifocal lenses which are more permanent? If the patient's already above the age of 50 and it's going to be effective again only for 5 years, then what is the big advantage and why not just go for a lens-based presbyopia correction?
I have done, the oldest patient is 55 whose lens was very clear, but yes, as a doctor I give the option. As you say, after the age of 50, I say you can either do a surgery or do a laser. Even if you do a laser, you have to definitely undergo the surgery, and surgery is a permanent. So some people have the thing that why operate when I can do a laser? So options is given. It's the patient's choice what they want either. I understand, sir. That's why I said scientifically also I would say that after the age of 50, if the patient has clear lens with no nucleus sclerosis, is it scientifically good to remove it or just give a laser correction and operate when they have the cataract?
Okay, so how does it behave once you've done a press bag, max, whatever film machine calls it?
Yes.
And then the patient develops cataract after 10 years, you do a cataract surgery, which IOL do you put and how do the patients fare then?
For monofocal IOL, yes, it does give a bit of multifocality, but if you are planning for a multifocal IOL, negative aspheric multifocal IOL is much more preferred in terms of these patients. And after the after 3-4 years, actually it does go off.
Okay, the effect goes off.
Yes, yes.
Is it because of epithelial hyperplasia?
Pardon, sir?
Is the effect lost because of epithelial hyperplasia, or why does the, how does the cornea change?
Not sure of that still, sir.
Are the ones who are just becoming presbyopic.
Exactly.
They are the ones actually we need to target. The 40 to 45 year age group are the ones who are more disturbed. After 45, 50, then they are more adjusted to.
But then you do only monofocal correction for them if they are not having any power for distance. And if they are having power for distance, yes, I would say that you're going to correct just 1.5, ma'am, when you come to around 40 to 45. If you're above 45, if you're nearing 50, then you correct a little more higher for near so that it stays for a longer time. That is all. It is not that you cannot do. People who are saying to me that I want it done, I do it. Even at the age of 42, I say yes.
So is there touch-up possible in this kind of thing? Can you lift the flap after 5 years and then again enhance it?
Not had a follow-up for that time, ma'am.
Usually we don't advise re-touch-up in such procedures, because then you lose a lot of contrast sensitivity.
Mm-hmm.
So usually you should tell it to the patient that this is like lifestyle convenient procedure. This is not a perfect procedure for a person who is working on PC for longer time, 8 hours or 10 hours or something. Usually you will find the status of presbyopic surgery right now is usually the housewives are happy.
Mm. Yes, very true.
The working people, they are really not, say if you want to see the percentage, almost 20 to 30% of the patients, they usually complain something or something, they start coming up again to you, those who are working people. But usually if you find those kind of people like housewives and those who are beparis and they just want to fill 230 rupees and take notes and something, for them, all presbyopic surgeries, they are happy. But usually for working people and usually the lifestyle people who those who are working more on PC, they're not happy with any presbyopic surgery available right now.
Very true, sir. Yes, sir. For them, you have to do only monofocal.
So one eye,
the dominant eye, you leave it for distance and you correct only the non-dominant eye for near. And these patients are the one you definitely have to take them to your refraction cubicle, put in the power of minus either and tell them to close their eyes and see. Because if you just tell them to keep both their eyes, they will read distance and near. So you tell them to close their eyes and see. So then they will say, sir, I'm not able to see anything with this eye. Then you do the other eye. Then you tell them, open both your eyes and see. So you say that this is what you will definitely get post-operatively.
But this hybrid will not work for such patients, the hybrid for both eyes?
No, sir. Because the patient who's already having 6-6, you're going to make them around 6-6 partial and 6-9 in the dominant eye.
And how easy is it to do enhancement if you do a case and it is not perfect?
That's what as not perfect in terms of, yeah, reversal is going to be easy after 6 months to a year's time. That time you're going to take the flap, the same flap as it is. But enhancement after 5 years, still a question mark.
Right. Enhancement is not possible not in this procedure.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Friends, I hope 80% of the crowd is here is presbyo. And I would just ask my friends, like they can raise their hand, those who want to lose their presbyopic correction. Nay, whatsoever is there, like those who are presbyo and don't want presbyo. See, of course, like presbyopia, rather than say it's a huge upcoming subject, because you'll find a lot of patients they need, and they really after 42, 45 years, many of them, they definitely come to you and ask you, say, can it be done for me? Say, many of them, like if you make in your consulting room, the posters have labeled that after 40 years, you can lose your glasses. Ask us. So many of them, they are really curious after the age of almost 45 years. We have got a small study, what we have done on corneal inlays. So corneal inlays is a very interesting subject because one thing is it can be reversible. And what you are interested, like it can be retouched after some years. If you want to change your correction, you can change the inlay. That's very simple. We don't have any financial interest into that. As you must have seen that almost 80% of our friends, they have raised their hands for their presbyopia reversal. And there are different techniques like available right now. There are more than almost 1.5 dozen procedures available for presbyopia reversal. So some of them are scleral. One of our friend has put down, more people are in favor of corneal. And of course, like some of them are now interested after the age of 45 or 50, whether you want to still go ahead for corneal or then lens-based. So many lens-based procedures also are coming up. And of course, many of them surgeries because of the, rather than like the fineness, the expertise available here, you find the presbyopic surgeries are becoming safer and safer. So many people, they opt for that. And many surgeons, they are coming up for adding these procedures to that. So in Palicaris presbyopia surgery algorithm, so what he prefers is between 40 to 45 years, the monovision correction is preferred, the multifocal laser as this thing, and conductive keratoplasty at that time for hyperopia and intracor. What is more important age group we are interested is 45 to 55. So for that, like for myopes and hyperopes, you will find between 45 to 55, the monovision, multifocal laser, and conductive keratoplasty for hyperopia are the preferred procedures. And above 55, usually you find for emetrope, you don't touch those patients, those who are above 55. But for other things, like after 55, you can choose clear lens extraction with accommodative or multifocal IOL. How to manage a plano presbyopic patient between 45 to 55 year old? Of course, the corneal laser, like LASIK myopic monovision, 2-volt clear lens extension, because he is too young for that. But we need a method for this target group, which is minimal invasive and reversible too. So intracorneal implants. The corneal inlay, the intracorneal lenses are very thin, almost like 20 micron to 30 micron in thickness, implanted in mid-stroma of non-dominant eye. It improves the uncorrected visual acuity for near distance by modifying monovision approach. There are different intracorneal inlays available right now or being tried. What we have tried is FlexiView, Presbyopia micro lens. Camera is, of course, one of the popular lens, and the Presbyopia lens by Revision. So in FlexiView, the design is such that the center of the inlay is without refractive power, and the periphery one is it works for near vision, and it's from plus 1.25 to plus 3 diopter. So it works like the central one works like a pinhole effect and gives better depth of focus. Of course, the thickness is 20 micron, and you'll find the central one works for far vision. The major myopia effect in pupils with 3 to 5 millimeter diameter. The effect decreased in far vision where the pupil was increased in diameter more than 5 to 6 millimeter. This is a concept of smart monovision. The implantation is done previously with keratome, and now the femtosecond intral is 150 to form a pocket, and this pocket is formed say around 5.5 millimeter to 6 millimeter, and you are seeing the inlay is put in. It is, the inlay is centered for pre-surgical position of the first Purkinje reflex, line of sight. The procedure is hardly done in 2 minutes. And what you see after the surgery is performed on second or third day on slit lamp examination, you find the corneal inlay appears like hello. And what we had done, 31 at the University of Crete, the study was performed with Professor Palikaris and Cuminis. 31 plano presbyopic patients were enrolled and underwent flexi-view corneal inlay implantation. 18 males, 13 females. Mean age was 45 to 52 years of age. The minimum follow-up was 6 months, and mean depth of pocket was 285 micron. And you'll find the efficacy of for near vision was almost like after 1 month, it was almost 63%, and after 3 months, it was almost 77%. 100% of the eyes have uncorrected visual acuity for near better than 20/40, or better, 77% were 20/20 and 20/25. With excellent efficacy. This is uncorrected distance visual acuity in the operated eye. The mean pre-op was 20/20 and mean post-op was 20/40. So there was not much loss of distance vision also. And so this is something like you had not very much compromised distance vision and near vision as you do in monovision corneal surgeries. None of them lost more than one line of best corrected visual acuity for near as well as far vision after the procedure. The safety, of course, like what we need to look at when you are doing any intracorneal procedure is the confocal microscopy has proved that it is totally safe. The comparison of other inlays. And in conclusion, early study shows that corneal inlays demonstrated good efficacy of gain in unaided near vision with minimal compromise on unaided distant vision in plano presbyop. It's very good for people, those who are plano presbyop. This minimal invasive and reversible procedure demonstrated good safety and maintenance of the corneal structural health in our group of patients. New technology merits further long-term studies because you need to still go for, say, more years with this corneal inlays. But whatsoever we had done, a small group study, we are happy. And for plano presbyop, we could find that this is excellent, reversible procedure. And you can definitely choose then after 55 years any lenticular procedure, lens-based procedure, as required or demanded. Thank you for your kind listening. Of course, that what I said, the study is, I won't say in large number, it was only 31 implants what we had done.
So has it been used in India, or the study is only of Greece?
No, we had done 7 implants in India, and other were done in Greece. Thank you. So with this, I would thank our co-instructors to help us and to create an interest into our friends, those who had come all the way for their reversal of presbyopia. Thank you very much.